morning and good to have you with us on this edition of the Urban Debate. Viewers, we all have heard our politicians express their love for our soldiers, our armed forces. It is often mentioned in their speeches. It is often shown during poll campaigns. In fact, recently, some even went to the extent of calling our army Modi Ki Sena, because that is how much at least one political party wants to say and prove that they care for our armed forces. But when it actually comes to action, when it actually comes to policies, when it actually comes to crucial decisions for the welfare of our soldiers and their families, just how honest and committed are our politicians? That is a big question tonight. Because in my hand is a circular issued by the Government of India, Ministry of Finance, the Department of Revenue, from the Central Board of Direct Taxes, that's the CBDT. This is a circular, a clarification that has been issued on 24th of June. And this goes on to define who is eligible for tax exemption for the disability pension. In simpler words, if you are a soldier who suffered from a disability while serving your country in our army, in our navy, or the air force, are you eligible for tax exemption once you retire? There was a lot of confusion. Many sought clarity from the government. And according to this circular, if your disability is to the extent that you cannot serve in our forces anymore, that you are invalided and you must leave the forces, only then do you get this benefit. Only then are you exempted from income tax. If you are a soldier who in a war or in a counterinsurgency operation have suffered a serious injury that has led to a disability that may get you a desk job and not a field job, but you continue to serve your country for the next several years and complete your tenure and then get retirement, then you don't get this exemption from tax even if you are disabled. That's essentially what this circular seems to be telling our soldiers. And that has left our veterans fuming. General VP Malik, former Army Chief, tweeted, in fact, saying that this circular amounts to the government asking Faujis not to take physical risks in war or even in peace. How do we make the civilians in the Ministry of Defense understand this? Is this the right way to go? Is there a legitimate concern that our soldiers have? And doesn't this prove and show that our government and our politicians have double standards when it comes to their so-called love for the armed forces? Let's open this up for debate and say good evening to our panelists. Maruf Raza, strategic affairs expert and a consulting editor to our network. Air Marshal M. Mateshwaran joins us this evening. Colonel H. N. Handa, senior most war wounded veteran. He is also the chairman of the disabled war veterans in our country. Abhishek Mishra, leader with the BJP. Vivek Agnihotri, a retired IS officer, former secretary general of the Rajya Sabha. Let me first go across, in fact, to Colonel Handa and ask him, Colonel, there were a lot of, you know, clarifications that had been sought. This is what the circular says. How is this being interpreted by the soldiers and the veterans?
Is that for me?
Yes, Colonel Handa, that is for you.
Yeah, well, the question is that the order that has been issued, whoever has made it has quietly forgotten to consider section 28 of the same section, ruling that they have quoted. Section 28 is for those who are disabled in war, who are wounded in war, they are also exempt. Section 29 is for those who are invalided out of service. Now this is, and the people who have been wounded in war, the government has now compared them with the ordinary disabled, like people with blood pressure or others who go out of the service with disability. Now that is a differentiation which is not accepted. A war wounded person must be dealt separately, and if he is exempt, he should be totally exempt from the income tax. It is a disincentive for a person to go tomorrow into war, because if he gets wounded, he is not going to get any benefit whatsoever. And I think this is a very wrong move that the government has done, and they should rescind this order immediately.
Just to understand how things stand right now, Colonel Handa, if you can explain to our viewers, what is the current system that is followed? Do all soldiers who've been disabled while in service to our country, are they all exempted right now? What is the system that works right now?
Right now, the all disabled, whatever category they might be, may might fall under, they're all exempted from income tax.
Okay.
Some of them, there are some issues where people have misused the system, but that does not mean to say you punish everybody. You can't treat a war disabled person, especially as a person who is misusing the system. He has been disabled and he has been wounded in war. He has got a certain amount of disability, and therefore he has to be paid for it. And he has been getting exemption all along, and now you are withdrawing this, that means that, in other words, you are trying to withdraw all the facilities that you have given so far.
Yes, absolutely. Maruf, if you could come in on this at this point, it seems to me that this circular is sending a message that if your disability is not so serious that you continue serving in the armed forces, then perhaps it's not big enough to be respected and for us to give you those benefits. I mean, if it is called a benefit, I don't see it as a benefit.
Well, you know, Tanvi, this entire issue of disabled soldiers has been on and off within military circles, been debated a lot, because this has many elements to it. The first element is, and I recall very clearly an article written by Major D.P. Singh, who became famous as the Blade Runner, because one leg was blown off in the Kargil conflict because of shelling that landed near him. And, you know, he now is very famous for running marathons with one leg. But that doesn't mean because he's got the willpower that you deny him the benefits, because it took him a long time to convince the establishment that, you know, he is disabled. And it is another matter that, you know, he has an iron will, just like so many other generals who've risen to very high rank without their legs because of their willpower. General Cardozo comes to mind, General Oberoi comes to mind, and General Yogi Sharma comes to mind, you know, people who used to swim, who used to jog, who used to do everything else, despite not having legs, because they just had the willpower to go on. Doesn't mean you deny them benefits, but I think there is a more important point. And the more important point is that, you know, there is a covenant between the state, that is the nation state, and the soldier, that you put your life and your limb on line and we will look after your interest whether you're alive or not. Now, this is quite clearly something which is going against the basic covenant, which inspires men to go and put their most precious elements in the battlefield, in the line of duty, in the name of the country. Because as was brought out, that if you know at the end of the day that as he's no more, Colonel Anil Kaul V. Chakra once wrote a book, Better Dead Than Disabled. Because as a disabled soldier, you have to keep doing the rounds of various organizations to get your dues. And in many cases, if you are seriously disabled, you're not able to get yourself another job after retirement. Now look at the case of America. You know, those who hire companies that hire veterans and disabled soldiers, the state there gives those companies tax benefits of up to $9,600 a year. And here we are denying them the basics they get by imposing a tax on them. And then you have every politician of every color having used the military to do chest thumping during the election rallies and talk about how brave our soldiers are. Yes, our soldiers are brave. They help you achieve your political aim and your agenda. What are you going to do for them now? That is what upsets me. Because the fact of the matter is, when it suits you, you use the servicemen. When it suits you, you abandon them. And lastly, there's something known as the Armed Forces Tribunal. Now, the Armed Forces Tribunal, though has been given a lot of powers, does come out very effectively in many cases to solve an issue before it goes to KE court, because a lot of officers were going into court for a number of petty issues. But it also blocks, by virtue of its existence, the right of a soldier to take recourse to the highest courts of the land, that I've lost my ability to function normally and you're not giving me my dues. Why? Because somebody who's sitting and making the rules and filing various notices is not conversant with the conditions under which people have to struggle to eke out an existence when you lose a limb and you are still around.
Right.
And I think there needs to be greater interface between the military and the civilian bureaucracy to understand some new parameters that need to be enforced. You cannot, you might as well go case by case in every case. You can't have standard run-of-the-mill rules. And I know, out of my own experience, that how pedantic the bureaucracy can be, where they pick out one word in one document that you've written and deny you all your privileges.
Right. And I'm going to take that point in just a bit. But first, let me ask Abhishek Mishra to respond on the first part of what you raised, Amaruf. Abhishek Mishra, जब सर्जिकल स्ट्राइक के नाम पे वोट्स लेने होते हैं तब आप लोगों को बहुत प्यार आता है हमारे फौजियों पे, तब तो आप मोदी से की सेना और मोदी की सेना बोलते हैं, लेकिन जब एक्चुअली में कुछ करने का टाइम आया तो आप कह रहे हैं कि इनकम टैक्स एग्जेम्पशन नहीं मिलेगा इवन दो यू हैव बीन डिसेबल्ड बिकॉज यू सर्व्ड एंड फॉट फॉर योर कंट्री. ये कैसा लॉजिक है?
Tanvi, you are trying to spin things. First of all, nobody has asked for votes in the name of our Faujis.
Oh, is that
every
so?
Citizen of India, irrespective of any political party. Let me reply, Tanvi. Silently, every citizen of India is, you know, we all respect our armed forces and they have done brave acts and saved our country since independence. So it has nothing to do with elections or votes. So I request once again. First of all, nobody has asked for votes in the name of Faujis. We all respect our Faujis. And it has been all throughout, nothing to do with elections. Second point. Now, with regards to this particular exact issue of the pension, now CBDT is also, you know, one of the agencies which has worked on this and removed this. Now, see, they will definitely, you know, because the issue has come up, maybe the CBDT has not gone into a detail of how the our soldiers, army men, how much the trouble they're taking. So it's a taxation issue. Maybe, could be, there could have been a mistake, and definitely the Honorable Finance Minister has not made any statement on it. So definitely, it will be reviewed, seen. Maybe the
are you telling
are not
me that these
detail.
Decisions are taken by your government?
No. Let me reply.
Let me reply.
No, Tanvi Shukla. See, you want to use such words like damn, etc., have some fun on national television? It is your duty. My duty is to give a serious reply.
What is the serious reply here? That you love your art soldiers and then you don't use them for political benefits. But here you're telling me that an important policy decision has been issued as a circular by some person carelessly by the CBDT department and the government doesn't care about it or doesn't know about it.
Tanvi Shukla. When the rest of the panelists spoke, you did not interfere. Now you want to, you know, create some hype, say, use the word like, damn, don't use such words, first of all. Let me reply peacefully.
You have to tell me what I will use or will not use. Answer my question.
Some, you know, No. Why are you interfering? Let me reply completely. Let me complete. So, the Honorable Finance Minister has not, you know, given any statement. CBDT was one of the partners. It's a taxation issue. Now,
it's a taxation
your Times
issue.
Your Times report today. The Mirror News, the Times Group channel.
It's a policy issue, Mr. Abhishek Mishra. It is a policy that reflects the mindset of your government. That you don't think twice before taxing our war veterans. You don't think twice before taxing our soldiers who have been seriously injured and given a disability because they were fighting to protect you.
Don't do your leftist spin.
We don't need a leftist spin. Tanvi Shukla, a leftist spin is not required. We gave 1/1 pension. I'm bringing the truth now.
Leftist spin. Leftist spin. Wow. Report today says. Okay then. All
let
right.
Let me reply. Tanvi Shukla,
according
let me reply.
To the BJP, this is a leftist spin that
complete.
I am giving.
No,
but
let me
what
complete.
Message do you think the soldiers are getting for this?
Your
no, you have completed.
Today.
You've
no,
already told
no,
me
no,
that
no,
the finance
complete,
minister
no,
will issue a
no,
statement.
Me, no,
what else do you want
you didn't
to
let
say?
Me complete. You didn't
if
let
you
me
are
complete.
Not the finance minister,
no, no,
what else
me
can
me
you add to
your
this?
Times of India today says. Your Times of India says today, Times of India says that there were some reports received, representation received by the officials of the finance ministry, wherein some officers, as one of our lieutenant general said, Andaji, that some officers just before retirement.
Watch where you're going with
certificate.
That allegation.
Based on those representations, there was a mistake.
Watch where you're going with that
no,
allegation.
No, I'm not going.
If
I'm
you
Times
tell
of India
me
said
that.
Time,
that the armed
Times
forces
of
are misusing
Times
this
Times
for their
said
retirement
that.
Benefits, which
no,
is
no,
why
no,
the
no,
government
no,
has
some,
designed this policy.
Some. Hence,
think about what you're going
hence,
to say
no,
here.
No, no, no. Some. Times of India is saying some. No, no, no. I'm
so,
saying.
Are you going to take away the benefits and the respect for all the war veterans?
No, no, we'll not. We'll review.
So why are
we'll
you
review.
Raising this issue
but
right now? What is the point
happened.
Of raising
Times
this issue?
Times of India said this has happened.
What
no,
is the point of
Times
raising this
of
issue?
Times of India has said it this today. Times of India.
What I have you guys
my
done. What have our MPs done for this country? You all can't even turn up in the
no,
parliament for
so,
a constructive
no, no,
debate
no.
on the state of this nation,
we
on the water
review,
crisis in this nation. You
all
can't even get
review.
One single policy passed without an outage in this country. And you are going to sit here and judge our war veterans.
We will review this. No, no, we will review this. Our veterans have all the respect.
Tanvi,
we will review this order.
In?
The three of you review. But your Times of India says, don't scream, Tanvi Shukla. You want to hear the fact? Don't make a, your, I don't want your spin here.
But that's the response.
Okay, can
then.
I come in now? I think he's
yes.
had his way.
Air Marshal, go ahead, please.
Okay, can I come in, Tanvi? Okay, I think it's an order which is very poorly thought of. You know, anything, any disability to any soldier, air warrior or a sailor is attributable to service is a disability. Anytime you have, you know, whether it's in war or in peace, any kind of injury that can be attributable to service requires recognition depending on the various other factors that are given as part of the disability issue. Now, this is now to segregate this between somebody who's been totally invalidated out of service and somebody who continues to service, I think it's quite a very, quite a ill-informed and very poorly thought of, you know, policy. That is one. Let me come to the larger issue. We have to come to this kind of a state. There is a disconnect between the military service and the civilian population in what I call an absence of a national military culture. When we got independence, we had a lot of people, particularly in the bureaucracy, who had done military service, at least 50% of them had come into bureaucracy and done military service, and they understood. As decades moved in, I think in the last couple of decades, that kind of a generation has gone away. And today we have people who have had no military experience. There is no incentive for majority of the population to actually volunteer for military service. We don't have a policy that encourages that. You have no politician who is inclined to serve in the military. And then they want to take policies, decisions with respect to the military or the military service and with respect to national service. I think when you look at as a country as a whole, and when you aspire to be a great nation and a great power, I think national military service and national military culture, building that is an extremely important one. And when you have a national leadership, a national civil services, showing the way, having been part of the military, will actually lead to better understanding of policies and better crafting of policies. So when you now take examples like, Maruf raised the example from the US, that's because majority of these senators tend to have had military service. You have a national leader whose children would have served in the military service, military. And therefore, they understand how the policies matter and they craft the policies quite well. That applies to other major nations as well. This is a problem in our mindset here. In India, there is a major problem in this context. And I suppose, you know, unless you actually allow the bureaucrats and the civil service, other civil service, officers serving the Ministry of Defense and the Ministry of Finance and in the taxation departments to actually go and see the service conditions and see what happens. For example, if a pilot during peacetime, during an exercise, ejects and gets injured, he has a spinal injury. For the rest of the life, he has to live with that kind of a major injury. And he may be able to actually continue to be in service till he retires, meeting other avenues of service. That doesn't mean that he should be denied, the exemptions in the context of disability. So when George Fernandez from the same NDA, government, earlier NDA government, I think George Fernandez turned out to be one of the finest defense ministers. And this is an issue actually he actually recognized. He forced quite a few of the civilian bureaucracy in the Ministry of Defense to actually move and see conditions in Siachen. And he actually made them understand what these issues are. And therefore, I think that kind of an approach is necessary from national leadership.
Right.
I think you leave it to individual departments and individual civilian bureaucracies to craft policies. There will be a major fiasco like what is actually happening now.
Right, absolutely. And I completely agree with you. But let me ask Mr. Vivek Agnihotri on that. Mr. Vivek Agnihotri, what Air Marshal Matheswaran said and even Maruf was referring to, this disconnect between the bureaucracy and the armed forces and maybe a failure to understand what the real conditions and situations are. Do you think that's a significant problem when it comes to policy making?
Well, I would like to begin with making some comment on the legality of this order, because on the merits of the order, a lot of discussion has already taken place. Apparently, a distinction is sought to be made between those persons who are pensioned off because of the disability with immediate effect and those others whose disability is not so serious, and they then retire in due course after full service, as you mentioned in the beginning. So let us call them type 1 and type 2 type of cases. Now, the very first issue to be decided in this case is that if this type 2 is what is being affected by this order, that is those who complete their full service and then they retire and they carry some disability on account of which a lot of other problems are there also, in terms of their promotion and other things, etc. And as somebody mentioned, post-retirement employability. Now, it is not clear from the order whether it applies, this type 2 disability relating to order relating to type 2 disability, whether this order applies to all those persons who will join the service henceforth. Does it apply, or does it apply to those who are in service and in case they incur a disability, type 2 disability in future, they will have to pay tax? Or does it apply to all those as well who are having this disability and they have been sanctioned this other type 2 type of pension, the exemption from tax? So the order is not very clear. So that is the major issue which needs to be settled. The other thing I would like to mention is that this is a very ad hoc type of a decision appears that has been taken. The right way, as somebody mentioned, that there are some misuse of this facility is there. So there should have been a committee set up which would have gone into all the details and therefore come out with some more refined type of order, rather than just treating all type 2 cases on the same footing. As somebody mentioned, that type 2 type of disability can be either a war disability or it can be in the dual normal course of living. Somebody gets high blood pressure, somebody has a heart bypass, just that, which is not directly related to the war or a wound received during the war. So a committee should be appointed which should go into the cases type of misuse that is happening and then come to some reasonable or rational decision. That would be the way out, in my opinion.
Just on the first point that you raised, Mr. Agnihotri, I'm reading from this circular. In fact, the point of the circular was to clarify on that very query that you're saying. The question that was asked by many was, does it apply, does the tax exemption apply to what you're saying as type 1, or does it apply to type 2 as well? And the order, in fact, in the para 5 goes on to say, such tax exemption will be available only to armed forces personnel who have been invalided from service on account of bodily disability attributable to or aggravated by such service, and not to personnel who have been retired on superannuation or otherwise. So the larger interpretation is that this...
Madam, you have not understood my...
Yes, okay, let me
you
ask...
You have not then. Understood
no,
my
may
point.
May I clarify a little bit?
I am quite clear that this order applies to type 2 disability.
Yes.
But I am saying that order does not say that those people who join the army now, if they incur type 2 of disability, they will have to pay tax on pension, a special pension. Or it is those who are in service now, and if they incur disability subsequently type 2, or is it for people who will...
Right.
Who have already incurred this disability and they are already getting tax exemption, and that is being withdrawn.
Okay, I get your point.
You're saying
whether...
It is not very clear, that order.
What is not clear is whether this will be prospective or will it also be implemented retrospectively for those who are already serving in the army. Okay, I stand corrected there. But Colonel Handa wants to come in and clarify.
Correct, because the court...
Yes.
First
the
of all, let me clarify what Mr. Agnihotri said.
To be applied retrospectively.
Please allow me, Mr. Agnihotri.
Yes, Colonel Handa.
May I please say, Mr. Agnihotri, there is no type 1 and no type 2. Actually, what has happened is that after India signed that agreement, that people will not be pushed out of the service just because they've got a disability, the same type 1 became type 2. Means they also have disability exactly the same in nature as those who are invalided out. Now, those who are invalided out number at this particular moment of time only about 5,000 in number. But the total number of war wounded are in the region of about 10 to 11,000. Now, out of those 10 to 11,000, they would have been, if the orders had continued that they have to be sent out of the service, there would have been another 4,000 to 5,000 within this 4-5 that I've already mentioned. So therefore, as far as that is concerned, let's not talk about it. The disability pension for war disabled, whether they are retained in service or whether they are invalided out, should remain exempt. And that was the order that was there in the 1922 regulations, which this circular has mentioned. And they have quietly forgotten that in that particular circular, it is written very categorically that those people who were wounded during war will be exempt from service, not invalided out. Invalided out is Section 29, but Section 28 very categorically states that those who are wounded in war or warlike situations will be granted exemption in income tax. Therefore, there is no ambiguity about it. This order, probably somebody has written it without even any application of mind, as is normally applicable, and has created this problem. What does it lead to? It leads to a fact that in terrorist action that is going on in JNK, a person will be told, don't get wounded, otherwise you're not going to get anything. Therefore, don't take the chance. Just sit inside your bunker and let people die. That is what is going to happen. So please look at it from that angle. There is no ambiguity about it. It is applicable from 2019 to 2020. Not from previous years.
Again, I have not been understood. I have not said that there are two type of disabilities. I started my intervention with the observation that ostensibly this circular tries to make distinction between these two types. I never said that these two types exist. I am saying that this order is creating this type of two types. That is what I said.
It is a disincentive. This order is a disincentive
which is not based on any logical logical,
that he was
logical
not
reasoning or logical.
Okay, I think like Colonel Handa, Vivek Agnihotri also agrees that this order doesn't have a rational basis to it and may need a relook. But let me also come back to the point of this differentiation. And Maruf, then, is there a need, like you also raised, that sometimes this may be misused? But how do we, you know, distinguish? Because there is one category of soldiers who may get a serious injury or a disability in a war zone. In action, there may be other kind who get this in while counterinsurgency operations are on, while you're in hilly terrain, or if you're serving in Siachen, or if you're flying, test flying, in training, and your plane crashes. There are so many different instances or types where you may suffer from this disability. How do you decide who gets exemption or not?
Yeah, that's a very good question, Tanvi. Actually, I was coming to that. The point is that the
Air Marshal, I'll come to you next. Maruf first, and then I'll go across to Air Marshal Mateshwaran.
The hazards of service are such that while somebody in his wisdom at some stage would have declared that in war zone, if you get this, you'll get 100% disability, or 90% or 80%, whichever what the medical board finally decides on your level of disability. But the fact of the matter is that, you know, in today's world, we need to really understand what is a war zone. India hasn't fought a full-fledged war since 71. And in Kargil, which I don't call a war but a conflict, because all our resources were not used to its entirety. But the fact of the matter is, did the service headquarters declare subsequently other operational areas as dangerous as war zones? And what happens that if you lose your life in a training exercise, when you become part of a sort of a firing that takes place by mistake and you do get shot dead? Now, are you meant to be a walking dead because you didn't die in war? So therefore, the disability is going to be, or the pension is going to be denied to you. So, you know, these decisions are better left to senior commanders, and I would like and urge senior commanders at all levels in the military to A, push for this, that this should be in our turf, just like operational decisions, when to use the Air Force fighters or when to use the soldiers in what kind of operational situation is best left to military commanders, and that's an agreement that has come to prevail between the civilian and the military leaders. Also, what is a war zone? How much the soldiers should get the benefit? We should be generous towards that, because unfortunately, there are too many cases. Do you know, out of 16,000 cases that are in the courts about pensions, about 50% of them are about the inaccurate description and division of the pensions, many of them virtually related to disability pensions. So the fact is that there are many in the leadership who are more loyal to the crown than the crown himself. Let's not blame the politicians. The politicians will tell you, okay, these are the briefs under which you can give the disability pension. Now get on with it. But what happens is that our own medical courts of the IMA, the army, the medical committees, decide to be so stringent with the implementation of the yardstick that a poor chap who doesn't have a full leg and is now disabled with one leg gone still has to fight for years to prove it to the establishment that he's actually disabled. And it takes 7,000 to 10,000 rupees to fight every appearance in the court. Imagine how much money an officer has to spend to finally get his dues if he gets it. And do you know something? The MOD is the biggest litigant of the government of India's departments or ministries, fighting cases against his own soldiers, trying to prove a disabled that he's not disabled. I mean, we are in a very bizarre situation, and you're not going to have people willing to come out and die for you to live up and support operations which are in effect an outcome of political mismanagement, because they know that you're not going to hold their hand when they die or they are disabled. So We as a nation must address this issue in a more comprehensive manner instead of going in a legal round circle and constantly trying to find ways why it's not done. I think Air Marshal Mateshwaran made a very important point. We need to get more sensitized to the culture of the military. There is no other service in this country or anywhere in the world which asks for you to make a supreme sacrifice of your life and then in the line of duty. You cannot quantify it by getting people to fight over money and what should be due to a dead or a disabled. It is disrespect that you are giving to those honorable men.
Yes, and then to sit and measure them on just how disabled are you. Are you so disabled that you can't do any work, or are you disabled but can continue to do some kind of work and so we don't need to give you any tax exemptions? It's ridiculous, and especially from a party that that claims to be the one that stands for the soldiers and the armed forces, to the point that Maruf was making. And let me add to that. Between 2014 and 2017, the BJP government filed 800 appeals in the Supreme Court against tribunal rulings in favor of the disabled soldiers. So the government actually went against these rulings. The tribunal had ruled in the favor of the disabled soldiers, said give them what they're asking for. The government decided in 800 cases to go to the Supreme Court and challenge those decisions. Here is a specific example. Puneet Kumar Parikh was a retired squadron leader with the Indian Air Force. He suffered a spinal injury while working on a Jaguar aircraft. It's not as if he was driving on a vacation and he got injured. He was working on a Jaguar aircraft and suffered a serious spinal injury. He was declared permanently disabled. He was denied a disability pension before he opted to take premature retirement. Now, this happened in 2004. That also goes on to show you it's not just one political party. These are how governments treat our armed soldiers. The tribunal ruled in his favor in 2017. And guess what? The defense ministry went to the Supreme Court against the tribunal's order. It was the Supreme Court that actually dismissed that appeal. So, Mr. Abhishek Mishra, why does the government want to fight every single case where a tribunal, a quasi-judiciary body, has already ruled that they deserve the pension, the disability pension? Why does the government then feel the need to question that and challenge that?
Yeah. As Mr. Maruf Raza rightly said, many times what happens is that the government has given the disability pension, but then the military hospitals, which is under the administration of armed forces, many, as he said, rightly said, the military hospital itself, there is for years and years, the disabled person is made to wait and check, etc. So it's also a question mark on the military hospital, as Mr. Morofuji has said, and maybe there should be some overlooking that also. Secondly, we fundamentally believe that any war, any AFA soldier who has been wounded in a war situation, he should get all the benefits, and hence, the officer or CBDT fans who has done this, definitely there will be a review. And we definitely believe anybody who has been generally wounded should get. Yes, there was some representation by some people that, you know, some people had taken last moment disability certificate to get higher pensions. But then for some people, all the other people who have been generally wounded in a war situation, they should not, you know, be affected. So hence, I agree with what Mr. Maruf ji is saying and Mr. Handa ji is saying, that any person who has been affected in a war situation, in a real disability, he should get the benefit. And definitely the people who have, some people who have done falsely, as the Times of India report has said, and as Mr. Conor Handa also has said, some people falsely take a certificate in the last moment, and due to which this order was passed by the official due to some representation. But definitely this order should also see the fact people in real war situation should be given benefit. But as it's also administration issue, as Mr. Maruf ji said, it's also the military hospitals which are involved, etc. So Tanvi Shukla, instead of trying to just blame the Bharatiya Janata Party, you must understand it's a procedural issue. Definitely,
procedural
it will be overlooked. It's a matter of tax. And definitely,
the
people who.
Mr.
Tanvi Shukla, don't interfere. Don't interfere. Tanvi Shukla. Tanvi Shukla, you want
to
spin.
Because the government didn't want to give the disability benefits to a soldier. Abhishek Mishra, don't try yelling. I'm going to go across to Air Marshal Mateshwaran, who's been wanting to make a point. Can we just listen in to Air Marshal Mateshwaran, please? Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, Tanvi, I just want to clarify a few issues because everybody talks about war situation. And I, as I said in my previous comment earlier, Disability attributable to service, whether in war, in peace, during exercise, in training, at any time during the service, is a disability issue. And that is, of course, graded in service depending on the extent of injury and extent of disability. Your pension is graded accordingly. So I think we should be very clear. So a disability arising out of during service, a disability that can be attributable to service conditions and service procedures is a disability. There is no doubts about it. Now, if we come to this particular order, now it differentiates between two aspects. One, where somebody who's been disabled and has been invalidated out of service, has been not being able to serve any further at all, is one case where they've got no ambiguity. They said, okay, that's fine, and he'll get all the benefit. But the assumption under the category 2 or type 2, as Mr. Agnihotri had sort of explained, is the assumption that people who are able to serve and continue to serve till their superannuation, the assumption is that they need not be considered for any advantages or any exemptions, because they've actually taken the benefit of the service. I think that's a very flawed understanding and a very flawed assumption. That is one. Second, as Maruf brought out earlier, if somebody is now, has a willpower and motivation, fierce motivation to continue to do service, then I think you need to recognize that fact. And I think General Oberoi, who became the Vice Chief of Army Staff, is a classic example of that kind of a motivation, where he had lost both his legs. So I think, the very assumption that some people have misused in last-minute, disability certificates, etc. If people have misused, please target individuals. Those people who misused it, you can come down heavily on them. And those systems that have actually created that kind of a misuse, please come down heavily on them. But not this kind of an order, which is completely an ad hoc order, ill-thought-of order, and I think it's not been discussed with anybody, not even with service headquarters, I understand. And I think this will create a major, major, ramifications in the overall service culture and service procedures. Lastly, let me again, I know this is the problem with our country, because you take military for granted. And contrary to what others have said, I believe the pride in a soldier, or in a air warrior and a sailor, of when he's in uniform, he will never compromise on his duty. He's not going to say, I will not take risk because somebody is tampered with this kind of disability issue. They will go into war knowing very well that they'll face death. And this is something I think our political system and our bureaucracy takes it for granted, that whatever we may tamper with, keep downgrading them, they will still do their duty. I think it's a very serious situation. I don't think we should actually tamper with military culture like this. I think we need to look at it more carefully. And the only way out is just rescind this order completely and go back to understanding the issue better.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. In fact, and we had a similar conversation the last time as well, and Maruf was also on the debate, where the point that came out is that perhaps even the top leadership of our armed forces should perhaps take a tougher stand with the government and in conversations with the government, maybe in this case as well, to say, no, this is not acceptable. What you're doing is a disservice to our soldiers, and it's going to be, in many ways demoralizing. And if you genuinely support our soldiers, hyper-nationalism aside, this is where you need to take a clear stand, and the government needs to right away look into this issue and clarify to us what exactly are they thinking. Do they support the CBDT order or not? Let me quickly go across to Captain Jagpal, calling us from Rohtak, a regular viewer of ours. Good evening, Captain Jagpal. Go ahead. What would you like to say?
Good evening, Tanvi. Honor to be on your show. Now, let us see what this BJP spokesperson has to say. He shouts at the mirror now and the people who criticize them, what he has to say about the facilities, canteen facilities. The officers who are VRC, PVC, martyrs, their family, they tell them that whenever you come to the canteen, you will have to give a thumb impression, that is local Aadhaar. Otherwise, you don't get your canteen services. You see, I have written twice to them that I will be forced to file a contempt. And now I can assure you, I'll file a contempt against the Defense Minister, Defense Secretary, Chief, and the Army Commander, Eastern Southern Command, who think that we are threats, we are petty criminals, We are unwanted in this country because we served with the utmost loyalty and we are decorated soldiers. Just to draw 2 kg of petty oil
right.
and 2 kg of surf, you want to treat us as we are the person in the Nazi camp, matter of shame for the government.
Right. Captain, I get what you're saying and I understand your sentiment. Let me also make it clear that politicians aside, most of our country doesn't really agree with what our politicians do half the time, and the respect that we have and that I have for our soldiers is, you know, beyond a certain level, and we completely, without any conditions, support and respect our soldiers and understand that the sacrifices they have made. And I think, which is why I wanted to pick up this topic, because I don't think it is fair to sit here and define the kind of disability and then to judge whether a soldier should be getting any tax exemption or not. Fact of the matter is, if a soldier has that drive, has the spirit in him to fight his disability, to still make something out of his life, to still serve his nation, to still continue working, doesn't mean that what he is going through is any less of a pain. And that is what perhaps our government and our politicians need to understand.
Absolutely.
And end that distinction right there. It's ridiculous to say that unless and until you're completely of no use to us, we are not going to give you this tax exemption. Perhaps the government needs to look at it right away. I wanted to quickly go across to Mr. Vivek Agnihotri on the other point that Mr. Agnihotri was made in the initial part of the debate. Do you agree that perhaps there is a disconnect when it comes to policies regarding the armed forces? Often I hear this, you know, from the soldiers, that the bureaucracy doesn't understand us, that they don't understand, and they make these policies which are completely sometimes bizarre, and they don't suit the soldiers.
No, it is not a question of army versus civilian. It is a question of, just as everybody has mentioned, that this order has been issued without going into the merits of the case. It can happen in any field. It can happen in health. It can happen in education. It has happened in this case in the armed forces. And therefore, as I have said in the beginning itself, that this whole issue needs to be re-examined. And if there are any misuse of this facility, then they should be sort of identified. And a very specific decision must be there, that this is excluded and this will be there, rather than just blindly saying that type 2 is excluded from disability pension.
Okay, completely out of time, but it was a pleasure to have all of you on this panel for this conversation. Think about it, viewers, in this way. Our Army and Navy and Air Force aren't just protecting our borders or fighting our enemies. They're not just called in to fight the terrorists. They're also called in to fight insurgency. They're also called in times of natural calamities. They're called in when there are floods, when there is an earthquake. They're called in even when there is an infrastructure that has to be made urgently, because otherwise we will end up losing more lives. For any kind of emergency, we look towards our soldiers. But be it the quality of the equipment, be it the quality of the infrastructure, be it the payment salaries to them, be it their pension or other benefits, at every single step, they have to fight hard to get what they should and what they do deserve. Why is that? Why is it that in our speeches, in our words, we claim to stand by our soldiers, but when it comes to real action and policies, we make them run around for every single bit that they deserve? That's something to think about for all our politicians and especially for this current government. Thank you so much for joining us on this big debate.